Namaskar, I'm Assistant Professor Kritika Dev from LG School of Law. Today we'll take up another topic of Indian Evidence Act. And now the topic is exclusion of oral by documentary. Can you get something out of it? Let me not create much confusion in your minds and let's straight away go to the sections. So when it comes to this topic also, it is divided under two parts. Now this is part one. And of course, we'll be having part two. So I've divided simply the sections. Some of the sections will be explained in this session and the others will be explained in the another session. Now what in overall exclusion or section from section 91 to section 100, it deals with exclusion of oral by documentary evidence. So generally, it deals with such situations where oral evidence has been excluded by the documentary evidence. So documentary evidence prevails here, right? So now with this, let's move on to the section. Now exclusion of oral by documentary. As you can simply see in the picture, somebody is speaking and the other is writing. So here when we'll read section 91, we'll see when it comes to the oral evidence, it will be excluded by the documentary evidence, right? So this is all about section 91. Now let's see what section 91 says. It says when the terms of any contract, grant or disposition of property. Three things when it is a contract or a grant or a disposition of property. And when it is reduced into writing, then no secondary evidence, only that document or, excuse me, the secondary evidence of its content shall be produced as evidence. So when it comes to these documents related to a contract or a grant, or a disposition of property. And now when these things are in question, then, and of course, reduced into writing, if a contract is reduced into writing, then that contract or the contents of the contract can only be proved through a primary evidence or the secondary evidence. We have seen the situations under Section 65 when secondary evidence can be given. So only through these two mediums, no other medium. It means no oral evidence, only the documentary evidence is acceptable here. But of course, the sections has two exceptions also. Now, what are these two exceptions when it talks about that document itself? As I took an example, for say, if a contract had been reduced into writing, then that the contents of the contract can only be proved with the help of the primary, which means the document itself, or the secondary evidence. Now, it could be the copy, it could be the certified copy or whatsoever it is, right? But there are two exceptions of it. Now, what these exceptions says, appointment of a public officer, right? Now, when somebody is a public officer and that person has been appointed through writing, but if that person is there in the office, he did not show that writing to the court that I was appointed, this is my appointment letter through which I was appointed, right? Because he's the public officer here. Or the second one is a will admitted to probate. Now, probate is a document which we receive after the legality of the will has been proved. You receive it from the court, right? So when a will is admitted to the probate, then a probate is a sufficient document. You did not go again and again and show the probate and show the will also. Once you have received the probate, then the probate is the sufficient document here, right? So these are the two exceptions of this very section. Now, section 92 talks about no evidence of any oral agreement or statement shall be admitted for the purpose of contracting, for the purpose of varying, adding or subtracting. So when it comes to no evidence of any oral agreement or statement shall be admitted, right? So we have seen these four things. Kindly read this first one as contradicting. That is just the technical thing or the typing mistake. This is a typo error. Kindly read it as contradicting. It is not contracting, it is contradicting, right? So contradicting, to contradict it, to vary it, or to add or subtract any clause of it. When the document is reduced into writing, no oral evidence can be given if at all I have the document in my hand, right, and I show it in front of the Honorable Court. Now, I cannot by my oral evidence either add or contradict or vary or subtract any of the contents which are written in it, right, for the terms of any contract, grant or disposition of the property. Correct? When it comes to any contract which is there in writing, or any grant or disposition of property which is there in writing, I cannot by my oral evidence can add, subtract, contradict or vary the contents of the document. Is that clear? Very simple to understand. But again, this section also has exceptions. Now here, the first exception is if anything can invalidate the document, if anything can make that document invalid, then that oral evidence would be admissible. Now that oral evidence should be related to what? The first one, fraud. If by oral evidence it is proved that the contract was entered through fraud, then that oral evidence would be admissible, because that will make the contract invalid. Right, how will we make the contract invalid? By these six things which are mentioned here. So if I want to prove that contract to be invalid, or when it comes to proving a contract to be invalid, and if it was entered by fraud, then that oral evidence will be admissible. Or if it is proved that it was entered, maybe that grant or disposition of property or contract, there was criminal intimidation. Right, there was criminal intimidation, other person was criminally intimidated to do the same, then that will be acceptable, that oral evidence will be acceptable here. Right, or if by the oral evidence it has been proved that it proves the legality of the contract, it's somewhere the oral evidence proves that the contract is not legal, then also the oral evidence will be acceptable. Capacity of the party. If simply, you know, if we talk about contract, both the parties have to be major when are contracting. So if it proves that the parties were not competent, it proves that, of course, it will be proved by the oral evidence or by the parties who had seen them contracting that no, the other person was a minor. Right? So here it is about the capacity of the party. Or if there had been mistake of fact or law, then if the same thing is being given through an oral evidence, it will be acceptable. Or want or failure of consideration. If it is proved by the oral evidence that there was no consideration involved in the contract, there was no consideration, and consideration is an element of a contract, right? So if it has been proved through the oral evidence that there was failure of consideration, then that oral evidence will be admissible, right? So this is the very first exception that we discussed. Now, the second exception is when the document is silent on any terms, right? If the document is silent on any of the terms, then the oral evidence about that silent term can be given before the Honorable Court through the oral evidence. The next one is when there is a condition precedent. You know, when it comes to many of the contract or many of the grants, there is always, sometimes, not always, there are times when there is condition precedent. Precedent as in before the contract. There had been one condition. Now, when it comes to that very condition, of course, that was not written in the document. But if you want to prove that condition, and if you do so through the oral evidence, then that will be admissible. Right, because you're talking about a condition precedent, which is there before the contract. That condition should be fulfilled before that very contract. So that was a condition precedent the contract. That can be proved through the oral evidence. Cancelled or modified by oral agreement. Now here in the bracket, you can see that applicable only when the original was not required by law to be in writing. If a document is there which is reduced in writing, how can you cancel it by the oral, by an oral agreement? When it comes to something in writing, you need to say or you need to cancel it in writing only, right? So cancel or modification here is about the agreement which is not required by law to be in written. Like not required by law to be written, then the oral evidence can be given and that oral agreement will be admissible and you can come up with the oral evidence by stating the same, right? Okay, any usage or custom applicable to the contract. Now, if it is a contract related to business, let's take an example, and there had been a custom related to it, applicable on it, right, on a particular area on or related to that particular trade, then you can submit through an oral evidence that according to the custom, this contract shall be interpreted in this way only, right? Because there is a custom related to that very trade. So the interpretation goes like this according to the custom. So about that custom, you can come up with an oral evidence. The language of the document relating to any fact. So when it comes to the language of the document, sometimes it is not clear what the contract is trying to say. So when the language is not that proper in order to make the court understand properly, then the oral evidence can be given regarding the same in order to make that language clear, in order to make the court understand what the document is trying to convey. So with this, the exclusion, the one part is over, and we will see the remaining sections in the next part. Next part of the session. Till then, keep studying, keep revising, and thank you so much.